Let's understand animal tissues. Now, animal tissue classification is one of the most simplest classification to understand. We can broadly classify animal tissues as epithelial tissues, muscular tissues, connective tissues, and nervous tissues. However, each of these tissues we would understand in separate detail in advanced lectures, but here we would have an overview about each of the tissues. So, to begin with, the first one is epithelial tissue. Now, epithelial tissues, to understand simply, are flat. They are the tissues which are on the layer surface. Now, this epithelial tissues could be classified under two ways, simple and stratified. Then, under the simple one and the stratified one, the classification remains the same. What is the classification? It could be squamous, that means squarish in shape. It could be cuboidal, that is cubical in shape. Or it could be columnar, that is columns in shape. So based on the shape, it could be column-like, it could be a cube-like, a dice that you play with, or a squamous, which is on the epidermis, the surface. Now let's begin with the simplest one, the squamous. Squamous is the epidermis. Now this squamous is flat. It is plate-like and therefore it is also called as pavement. You go to the garden, you walk on a pavement and it's arranged in a squamous section. And therefore squamous ones are called as pavement epithelium. Very, very important, very, very simple to learn. The surface is thin. The most interesting feature is on the surface, wherever you see a bulge, definitely on this surface you won't be able to see microscopic bulge, but on the surface of the cell, if you see a small bulge, that indicates what? That indicates nucleus, as simple as that. So under a microscope, the identification becomes very simple. The cell surface or the wall is actually thin in the case of simple squamous. Good examples, blood vessels, epidermis of the skin, buccal cavity, Bowman's capsule in kidney. Then we have lungs, the alveoli of the lungs. All of those are examples of squamous epithelium. Coming on next is cuboidal. As the name suggests, cubical structures, or they could be polygonal, hexagonal in nature. Most likely cubical in nature. They have a nucleus which is present in the center. As you can see in the diagram, nucleus is located in the center of the cubical structure. That's one of the classic characteristics. Now, where they are present and what is the function? The most important function of cuboidal epithelial cells is excretion, secretion, gamete formation. So those are some of the common functions. Now, where are cuboidal cells present? Cuboidal cells are present in the germinal epithelium of the gonads. It's also present in the endocrine systems, for example, in thyroid, in the case of pancreatic glands, you have cuboidal epithelium. So to best understand, you can have in mind the major endocrine glands. That would give you a rough idea about where cuboidal epithelial cells are present. The next is columnar. Now, columnar are interesting. As they said, they are column-like. Now, interesting to note, it's not just the epithelial is columnar. Again, the nucleus is also columnar. So, it is a little elongated. That's what you can remember here. So, columnar, the nucleus is elongated, usually elongated at the base side. The next interesting thing is these columnar ones have numerous modifications. Three important modifications that we would understand. One is ciliated, the other is glandular, and the third one is sensory. Three important modifications of columnar cells. Ciliated, as the name suggests, would have cilia. Now, cilia and flagella we have already understood in the previous lectures. So, cilia is seen on the body of paramecium, a good example to recall back. Flagella in the case of Euglena, dinoflagellates. Now, cilia are small hair-like structures on the top of the columnar structure, and therefore we call it as ciliated columnar epithelium. Where it is present? In the nasal passage. It avoids any dust movement inside the nose. Also, in the uriniferous tubules, ciliated columnar epithelials are present. The idea of columnar cells overall, be it ciliated, glandular or sensory, is increase or help in the process of absorption. The next one is glandular. Glandular could be uniglandular or multiglandular. Now let's understand the difference between the two. Uniglandular is usually seen in the globulate cells in alimentary canal. Multiglandular is present in sweat glands, oil glands, which are also called as sebaceous glands in the body. The next is sensory columnar. Sensory columnar are ones which have free sensory end. And now, since they have free sensory end, where they would be present? On the sense organs, as simple as that. That means taste bud, olfactory sense in the nose. So there is where you have the sensory columnar epithelium which is present. Next coming to is stratified. Now, as I said, the three classification that we did, squamous, cuboidal and columnar, all of these three would apply to stratified as well. So you would have stratified squamous, stratified cuboidal and stratified columnar. So these are the various ways under which we would have the stratified epithelium. These stratified epithelium are, as the name suggests, stratified. That means more than one layer. So they have various layers of epithelium which are present. As you can see in the diagrams, they have multiple layers which are present. And usually the upper layer in certain cases could be of dead squamous epithelial cells. That's again important to note. So in the case of squamous, the upper layer is sometimes dead in nature. The idea is it remains tough and it protects the inner layers of epithelium, and that's the major reason why stratified ones are important to avoid any kind of mechanical injury. So this was the first classification. Coming on to the next classification is connective tissues. Now connective tissue is an interesting classification. Under connective tissue, we have three types of tissues. One is a proper connective tissue, which would include areolar, fat and ligaments or tendon, which are called as supportive ones, which are actually the connecting ones, right? Then the supportive ones are cartilage and bone, and finally the fluid, which is blood and lymph. So let's understand each of these one by one. So when I talk about the connective tissues, the proper connective tissues, areolar, adipose and fibrous. Under fibrous, we have white fibrous and yellow fibrous. What is the difference? The yellow one is the ligament. What is the function of ligament? It connects bone to bone. What is white fibrous? White fibrous is tendon. It connects muscle to bone. The one that connects muscle to muscle is known as fascia, which is not considered under the fibrous tissue classification here. So we have taken two, that's ligament connecting bone to bone, yellow in nature, yellow in color, elastic in nature, connects bone to bone, where this kind of ligaments are usually found. So when you have a bone connecting to another joint, okay, so at the ends of the joint you would have ligaments which are present. So ligament injury is a common injury. Then we talk about blood vessels, bronchioles, where ligaments are present. Where is tendon? Tendon is the point where bone would be attaching to a muscle. So that is one way, one place where you find tendon. Besides that, the dura mater in the brain as well as the spinal cord, that's where tendon. So coming on next is adipose tissue. Now adipose, as the name suggests, the function is fat. Okay, so it stores fat. It is oval in shape. The main function is storage of fat. Where is the common storage of fat? Below the eyeball, the region that we see is the area where you have fat storage. A lot of adipose tissue here. The area around brain, area in the heart are some of the areas. Now main function, as we say, storing fat. Besides storing fat, what would be the other important function? Insulation. Since it is storing fat, it would be insulating the body, and also it would give shape to the body. Along with that, one very important function, it helps in absorbing the shock. So fat acts as shock absorber. very, very important. So therefore, this is what is adipose tissue. Coming on next is areolar tissue. Areolar tissues are the most commonly distributed tissues. They are star-shaped and also called as fibroblasts. Now, there are various versions of areolar tissues. One of the versions is mast cell. Mast cell respond to allergic reactions. The next important one is when there is an injury onto the body, which cells would take into a, which cells would come into account? It's the areolar tissues again. So when there is a mechanical injury, then these areolar tissues would be actually responsible. Where are they found? They are found in the kidneys, below the skin, and some of the major functions, as we said, in the case of allergic reactions, mast cell are an example of areolar tissue. Similarly, secretion and heparin production is one another function of areolar tissue. The next tissues that we talk about is the vascular, the fluid connective tissues or the vascular tissues. Here we have two important ones, blood and lymph. Now blood is around 8 to 10% by weight. Now under blood, we say 55% of the blood by volume is made of what? It is made of fluid matrix. Now within the blood, there are two important things. One is the plasma, the other is the blood cells. Under the blood cells, you have WBC, RBC and platelets. Platelets help in immunity, helps in clotting. WBC helps in immunity. WBC are leukocytes, RBC are erythrocytes. Then the function of RBC is production of hemoglobin, right? So that's one of the important things that we understand. Coming on to plasma, under plasma, fluid matrix is one of the most important things. And then is lymph. What is lymph? Lymph is colorless. It does not have any blood cells which are present, and therefore it is considered as a middleman of exchange between the blood cells and as well as the tissue. Another important difference between lymph and blood is lymph usually has less protein and less fibrogen in contrast to blood. Now in the blood, we have understood the blood groups, the ABO, in a separate lecture, so we won't go into that detail for this lecture as of now. The next is the supportive tissue. Under supportive tissue, we have bones and cartilage. Now, bone is the bony structure which is mainly made up of phosphate and calcium. Now, within the bone lies the marrow cavity, where is the bone marrow, and there is where the production of blood cells takes place. So bone marrow is the cavity where production of the blood cells would take place. Usually, most importantly, in the long bones, there is bone cavity which is seen. The next is cartilage. Cartilage is an elastic material. There are chondrins which have chondrocytes, and these chondrocytes are the one which actually provide flexibility or elasticity, we can say, to the surface. For example, in the ear, in the nasal septum, we have cartilage which is present. So presence of cartilage is again important, and the role of cartilage, as we understood, is very, very important to understand. It provides support. The next is muscular tissue. Under muscular tissue, we classify it as striated, non-striated and cardiac. The striated one are also known as stripped. Unstated are known as unstripped, and then is the cardiac. Now, cardiac muscle is an involuntary muscle which is present only in heart, as the name suggests, cardiac. So, it's present only in the heart. It is very important that it has intercalated disc. The only one of the muscular tissue where intercalated disc are present is where? It is in the cardiac muscle. Now cardiac muscle, it is working 24/7. It pumps heart and it contracts tirelessly. The next is striated muscles. Striated muscles or the skeletal muscles, also called as stripped muscles, are voluntary. That means I want to move my hand, I have full control whether I want to move or not. The most important feature is it has alternate bands of light and dark color, as you can see in the diagram. So here is a dark band, light band, dark band, light band. So arrangement of a alternate dark and light band is a classic characteristic of a skeletal muscle, which is not seen in the case of smooth muscle. Smooth muscle is also called as non-striated or non-stripped. It is present in the involuntary organs, for example, the elementary canal, urinary bladder are good examples to explain the smooth muscles. Now, one very, very important thing. In the case of smooth muscle, what is absent? Sarcolemma is absent, which is present in the case of skeletal muscle as well as cardiac muscle. Which of the three have an ability to remain contracted? Now, unstripped muscles have the highest ability to remain contracted because they are involuntary, followed by cardiac, followed by skeletal. So that is again a very, very important thing that you must remember or know. Now, striated muscles or skeletal muscles help in what? The most common function is locomotion, movement, as we can understand, and also this gets fatigued. One another interesting example of skeletal muscle is what? Tongue muscle. If I want to speak, I'll use it. Otherwise, I don't. Okay, so that is an example of a skeletal muscle. Coming on next is the nervous tissue. Under the nervous tissue, we have covered this in a separate lecture. So just to have an overview here, you have the nerve cells. Along with the nerve cell, there is nerve fiber. So nervous tissue could be explained as neuron plus nerve fiber. Now nerve fiber, the main role is to conduct the message from one part of the body to another part, to receive the stimuli and to send the stimuli. So sensory and motor nerves take into account this. And the next is the neuron. Now the structure of neuron is made up of two important components. First is the cyton. The cyton is the main cell body of the neuron, and along with the cyton, which is a star-shaped structure, it has a cytoplasm. The cytoplasm of the neuron is known as neuroplasm. Since it is part of the neuron, the cytoplasm of a neuron is known as neuroplasm. And then we have an elongated section which is known as dendron. Now under the dendron, we have the axon as well as dendrites. Now axon is a single long running chain which is present. The ends are divided into terminal arborations, which are known as terminals or the axon terminals. And then there is presence of dendrites as well. And these dendrites are present on the cyton. The structure on the cyton is the dendrites that are present. Now the message goes from one neuron to the another, where you have the neurotransmitters that come and play an important role. So this is the process through which nerve impulse moves to the brain, and brain sends the signal back to actually take a decision. So this is a very important aspect of nervous tissue. So to wind up, under the animal tissues, we have four basic classification: epithelial tissues, muscular tissues, connective tissues, and nervous tissues. Under muscular, we have understood it could be skeletal, smooth, or cardiac muscles. Under epithelial, broadly, it is simple and stratified. Under simple or stratified, again, both of these, there are three classifications, which are squamous, cuboidal, or columnar in nature. Then under connective, it is either a proper connective tissue, which is adipose, areolar, or fibrous, that could be tendon or ligament. It could be a supportive tissue, which could be a bone or a cartilage, and a fluid, which could be blood or lymph. So those are some of the basic categorization under animal tissue. So this was a brief introduction. If you have any questions, feel free to post those in the comment section. Thanks for joining in.